Nevada City policemen claim they resorted to panic firing when they killed a teenage boy whom they mistook for a criminal suspect. Now, the police officers made that admission during the Senate's probe on the death of Jim Boy Balthazar, but it remains unclear what caused the panic firing.
Bakit po nagpaputok? May banta ba sa inyo sa sandaling iyon?
According sa kanila, sir, nahahagaya na lang sila sa pagpaputok po sa tubig, sir. Parang kung tawagin, sir, yung panic firing, sir.
Ha? Bakit ka magpanic? Anong magbagi sa magpanic, di ba? Panic firing ang claim nila. Tapos pag tinanong natin, ilang bala pinutok mo? Isa lang, sir.
Police officer, meanwhile, was held in contempt for allegedly lying and evading questions. Police Captain Juanito Arabejo denied a paraffin test was ordered by Relieved the Botas Police Chief, Police Colonel Alan Uribe. But this was refuted by two other policemen.
Beses ko pong inutusan ang Chief Investigation Section at nung investigator in case na ipaparaffin test yung mga suspect, Your Honor. Nadinig po yan ng ibang officers, ilang beses kami nag-case conference, Your Honor.
There was no order to conduct paraffin test on the suspects.
Arabejo was taken into custody by the Senate after the question. Charges are brought against a dismissed policeman who is at the center of a road rage scandal. Senator Jinggo Estrada is calling for an inquiry into the incident. Sienna Brosio reports.
Tinakot, no? And siya pa ngayon magbabayad ng 500 pesos. I mean, where's the fairness in that? Kung meron man talagang kasunduan, ang tawag po dyan sa kasunduan na yan, it's a coerced winersa.
Quezon City Police District Director Police Brigadier General Nicolas Torre III disputes the declaration of Attorney Raymond Fortun that there was coercion in the settlement between the dismissed police officer Wilfredo Gonzalez, who drew a gun and hit the head of a cyclist in Quezon Avenue, Quezon City. Citing the CCTV footage from the Galas Police Station, Torre said the cyclist was not dragged by the ex-policeman when they walked towards the Galas Police Station. After 2 hours, the cyclist went out of the police station and shook the hands of Gonzalez's two children. He even tapped the shoulder of Gonzalez.
Hindi ko maintindihan kung saan kinukuha ni Attorney Fortun ng kanyang information. Ano? Pero siguradong hindi totoo yun na kinalankan.
But the QCPD still filed a complaint of alarm and scandal against Gonzalez at the Quezon City Prosecutor's Office. According to Fortun, the public can check the service record of Gonzalez, who is a dismissed policeman.
He's actually been dismissed twice. Way back in 2006, no, there was already a dismissal order against him. Also for the same reason, no, gross misconduct. And kaso, nag-apila siya. So instead, ang ginawa ng PNP is from, instead na ma-dismiss siya, dinemote na lang siya from PO3 to PO2. And then it was again on 2018, apparently, no, eh, parang hindi yata niya nakuha yung message or he didn't learn his lesson, 2018. Again, he commits a crime of grave threats. And dito na talaga, nagkaroon ng reklamo sa kanya and then he was dismissed from the service.
Both Fortun and the QCPD are requesting the victim to give his side to shed light to what had happened.
Practically, yung buong bansa ang talagang behind him, no, in support of him, praying for him. And ako mismo, I am praying, no, that he will change his mind.
Sana po ilumabas na siya. Huwag siyang mag-alala sa kanyang safety kasi ino-offer ni Attorney Fortun ang services ng Witness Protection Program.
Meantime, the LTO issued a show cause order versus the dismissed policeman Gonzalez. The agency is asking him to appear on Thursday, August 31, and explain and prove that he did not violate any traffic laws. Prior to this, the LTO also issued a 90-day preventive suspension on the driver's license of Gonzalez. In an interview in Teleradyo Serbisyo, DILG Secretary Benher Abalos reiterated that they will continue to monitor the case.
Minomonitor po ang ginagawa nila rito. Otherwise, kayo makakasuhan dito. Magmi-meeting kami, kung hindi mamaya hapon, tomorrow, tungkol to. Pinaparipaso ko lahat ng mga kasong ito.
Even PNP Chief General Benjamin Acorda Jr. wants his men to investigate further the case.
If there are things that were violated, kasi talagang kung ang kapulisan ay mismong makikita na sila ang nagbibigay ng insinuations that we are protecting this kind of actions ay medyo hindi maganda and we will not tolerate it.
The DOJ meantime issued a certification that Wilfredo Gonzalez is not in their personnel list. Z. Ann Ambrosio, ABS-CBN News.
Avila's chief aspirant shot dead outside a municipal hall in Cotabato province. Authorities said the killing came shortly after the victim, Haron Dimalanis, filed his certificate of candidacy for the position of village chairman of Maningao in Mitsayap, Cotabato. Other shooting incidents were also confirmed by Mitsayap Mayor Loli Sakdalan, which involved feuding families. Sakdalan has ordered authorities to beef up security measures for the filing of COCs. Perennial problems of classroom shortage and flooding greet public school students for the new academic year. Some schools in Parañaque and Quezon City struggle with over-congestion. Now to address this, two classes are being held in one classroom, while other schools implemented shifting schedules and online classes. In Bulacan, floods remain a big problem, which forced some schools to suspend classes. Despite these issues, Vice President and Education Secretary Sara Duterte believes learning should not be disrupted.
Dapat tuloy-tuloy lang yung pag-aaral ng mga bata. So, yun yung sinasabi natin na no learning disruption.
Meanwhile, DepEd also notes the opening of classes in 14 schools affected by the territorial row between the cities of Makati and Taguig have been smooth and orderly.
No untoward incidents. May nakita akong mga learners materials na galing sa Taguig, may learners materials na galing sa Makati, meron ding mga uniforms or school supplies na nakita natin dyan. Ang atin naman sa DepEd, if these are given to our learners for free, then we will not refuse them.
The Philippine Treasury Bureau has released the implementing rules and regulations of the country's first sovereign investment fund. These will take effect by September 12, 15 days after the publication in the government's official gazette. Philippine Finance Chief Benjamin Jokmo says the search has begun for the president and CEO of the corporation that will manage the fund. The rules specify the sources of government's 50 billion peso contribution to the Maharlika Investment Fund. It will come from 100% of the dividends of the Philippine Central Bank, its 10% share from the income of the Philippine Amusement and Gaming Corporation, 10% of revenues from other government-owned gaming operators, and proceeds from the privatization of government assets. The law creating the Maharlika Fund was signed by President Marcos in July, despite strong opposition from various sectors. State-run network Intercontinental Broadcasting Corporation, or IBC-13, appealing to government to reconsider its zero allocation in next year's proposed national budget. As President Jose Policarpio Jr. says, they have been unable to hand out the nearly 500 million pesos in retirement pay to former employees. And for this year, the network also receives zero funding in the National Expenditure Program.
When I entered the door of IBC-13, a group of retirees met me, and some of them even retired way back in 20,000. They have not been paid the retirement. Some of them around 25 died, and the rest are waiting for the payment of their retirees. There are so much unpaid retirement. Some even told me of bringing this matter to the Commission on Human Rights. Nakakahiya po. And it's my appeal to give most important to the payment of the retirees.
Lawmakers support IBC's call and vow to address the network's concerns.
Lahat po ng mga excess funds ng bawat tinitignan naman po natin. May chance naman po na makakahanap po tayo ng kung saan tayo makakabawas. Ang isang possibility is yung pension gratuity fund. Pero katulad ng nabanggit ni Sec. Chaloy sa akin, sinubukan na po nilang itap yung pension gratuity fund, although dinisapproved ng DBM. Yes, pero subukan pa rin natin ulit, itap. Kasi yun naman talaga ang appropriate fund source para sa retirement benefits ng ating empleyado.
Sad news, veteran Philippine broadcaster Mike Enriquez has passed away. He was 71. And news of his passing was confirmed by his home network, GMA7, Tuesday, during their flagship newscast, 24 Horas. GMA described Enriquez as someone who wholeheartedly served the Filipino audience throughout his 54-year career. Enriquez also anchored GMA's long-running public affairs program, Investigador. Our condolences to the Enriquez family and to his GMA colleagues. Weather watch as Goreng re-intensifies into a super typhoon. Let's get the latest on the storm's track from Pagasa weather forecaster Chanel Dominguez. Good morning, Chanel. Go ahead.
Good morning to everyone. So currently, Super Typhoon Goreng was estimated at all data over the coastal water of Sabtang, Batanes. It has a maximum sustained winds of 195 km per hour and a gustiness up to 240 km per hour. It is moving northwestward at a speed of 20 km per hour. Due to this Super Typhoon Goreng, we raise a tropical cyclone wind signal number 4 over the southern portion of Batanes and the northern portion of Babuyan Islands. Signal number 3, the rest of Batanes and the southern western portion of Babuyan Islands. Signal number 2 here in the rest of Babuyan Islands, northern portion of mainland Cagayan, and the northern portion of Ilocos Norte. Signal number 1, the rest of Cagayan, Apayao, northern portion of Kalinga, northern portion of Abra, the rest of Ilocos Norte, and the extreme northern portion of Ilocos Sur. According to the latest Super Typhoon Goreng might exit the Philippine area of responsibility with tonight or tomorrow morning and will likely to remain as a super typhoon until the Friday. And here's the update regarding the severe tropical storm Haikwe in the outside our Philippine area of responsibility. It was estimated at all beta at 1,580 kilometers east of extreme northern Luzon. It is expected to enter within this day and will be called Hana. And that's the latest here in Pag-asa Forecasting. Chanel Dominguez and good morning.
Thanks for that update as always, Chanel. Now, Super Typhoon Goreng along with monsoon rains caused widespread flooding in parts of Luzon and Visayas. In Cagayan, several roads and bridges at the town of Bagao are impassable due to a swollen river. The province of Batangas also reeling from floods as the southwest monsoon brings torrential rains. In the town of Lian, over 900 families were affected by flooding. A landslide was also reported along the Nasugbu-Maganyanes Road. Over in Iloilo City, more than 80 villages were submerged in floods, affecting hundreds. Goreng has so far affected over 63,000 individuals. Nearly 25,000 have been displaced.